Dear audience, it is my greatest pleasure to welcome you to this year's Army Summit. We find ourselves in the midst of a global pandemic, forcing us not only to adapt our strategic behavior and responses, but also the way we interact with each other.
Rest assured, if the U.S. is coming, there'll be tanks there. And the U.S. Army, we've fought alongside U.S. Army tanks many times. So don't worry about it. We'll be there and we'll have a lot of guns. And we have this old idea that if you're going into a gunfight, bring all your friends with guns. And our Marines will be clamoring to get on board and get over to Norway fast if we're needed. I was heartened to read in your long-term defense plan 2020 that Russia will have to consider that your maneuver battalions will be equipped, as Minister Bok Jensen just mentioned, with new main battle tanks, a critical consideration for anyone who has designs on your country. Main battle tanks are critical too for ensuring that your troops are well rehearsed in operating with top line tanks if NATO must respond operationally to a crisis anywhere. Along with the mobile air defenses and long range precision fires mentioned and called for in your plan, your Army will have the necessary elements to be a strong ground component.
The US Marines have shown dedications to come here and train under the very, very harsh Arctic conditions that we are more than pleased to offer. And that has been one important part of it, mastering the conditions. But the most important part from my perspective has been the level of trust we have been able to build. Norwegian soldiers and US Marines sharing dining facilities, sharing gym, sharing hardship out in the field, build relations which I think will be with us for centuries, but also will be very, very important if we will have to fight shoulder to shoulder, be it in Norway or be it in anywhere else. The Norwegian Army and also the heavy parts of the Norwegian Army are probably the only ones being, at least among the very, very few, being capable of operating this kind of equipment, these kind of units in the high north.
Capabilities are not everything. Actual high quality and capable contributions are also important. That's why we participate in the enhanced forward presence in Lithuania. Our armed forces must continue to prepare, to be prepared and capable of contributing to the security of our allies, as well as our own. We aim to continue our participation in the EFP, as well as our commitment to provide high quality forces to the NATO High Readiness Response Force. Norway also attaches great value to our good bilateral relations and cooperation with close allies. The United States remains our most important ally. We are also seeking cooperation and mutually beneficial agreements amongst other like-minded nations, such as UK, the Netherlands, France, and Germany. Last week, my Swedish and Finnish colleagues and I signed an agreement to further strengthen the cooperation between our countries on defense. Nordic cooperation makes sense, as it's likely that a threat against one affects us all.
Our vision is an army with flexibility in technology, rich in human competencies, and adequate depth in volume. An army soldier might still end up fighting an enemy using only his or her hands. Feel, hear, and smell the other person as they fight for their lives. This remains the harsh reality of war. Procedures and technologies are necessary pieces, but does not get us all the way. Trust, knowing each other together with a relentless will to fight, is what brings us success.
Velkommen til Army Summit dag 2. I dag skal det handle om fellesoperasjoner. Hva betyr egentlig fellesoperasjoner? I bunn og grunn handler det om hvordan våpengrenene i forsvaret jobber sammen for å løse oppdrag.
Det er vår evne til å utnytte fellesressurser for å oppnå felles effekt som kan senke risiko, påføre fienden flere dilemmaer og gi våre taktiske sjefer handlefrihet. På den måten blir vår samla kampkraft sterkere enn summen av delene hver for seg. Sagt på en annen måte, 1 pluss 1 blir mer enn 2. For det her dreier seg om å forsvare hele landet. Og da det også at vi bringer med oss de ulike styrkene, og for så vidt de svakhetene de enkelte av oss har, og til sammen at vi da klarer å styrke styrkene og redusere effekten av våre svake sider.
Som i dag så vil vi levere luftmakt innenfor fire kjerneroller. Luftkontroll, informasjonsinnsamling eller ISR, bekjempelse eller ildkraft om dere vil, og luftmobilitet. Til støtte for fellesoperasjoner og direkte støtte til de andre styrkesjefene. I 2030 så håper jeg at hele Forsvaret har gjennomgått et konseptuelt generasjonsskifte fra tradisjonelle luftfellesoperasjoner til det jeg vil kalle all domain operations. Der vi evner å skape flere dilemmaer samtidig for en potensiell fiende. I tillegg til land, sjø og luft evner vi å integrere cyber, space og EK på en effektiv måte. Her har Norge etter min mening et komparativt fortrinn som vi absolutt bør sørge for å utnytte de neste 10 årene. Vi er nemlig et lite kapabelt forsvar med tette bånd, høy tillit og lang tradisjon for fellesoperativ tenkning og samvirke. Dette kan vi evne å ta full synergieffekt ut av. F-35 vil være en katalysator i en slik utvikling, og er i seg selv en game changer innenfor både luftkontroll, ISR og bekjempelse mot luft, bakke og sjømål. Det fulle potensialet av F-35 tar vi imidlertid først ut ved effektivt samvirke på tvers av alle domener, med bruk av space, cyber, EK, luft, land, sjø og spesialstyrker.
En god investering med andre ord. Neste spørsmål. Kommando og kontroll, spesielt når du utfordres av en kompetent motpart, er vanskelig. I går snakket vi om hvordan fremtidens operasjoner vil foregå i det virtuelle, fysiske og kognitive domenet. Hvilke kritiske svakheter ser dere at vi må jobbe med i årene fremover? Nils Andreas?
Ja. Når det gjelder sammenkobling av disse kapasitetene, så er det sånn at jo bedre vi får det til, jo mer effektivt blir det. Sånn at vi må fortsette å videreutvikle effektive kommand- og kontrollsystemer som kobler oss sammen, og som er sikre, og som er robuste, sånn at de tåler påvirkning, og at de ikke totalt bryter det, men at de gradvis degraderes. Og ikke minst så har det med å videreutvikle vår lederfilosofi med intensjonsbasert ledelse, sånn at hvis det verste skjer og at du mister kontakten, så har vi flotte offiserer og soldater der ute som evner å operere på egen hånd i henhold til intensjonen. Og da skal veldig mye gå galt før vi feiler. Så bygge robuste systemer som gjør at vi er enda mer effektive, men samtidig bygge mennesker og ledelsen opp sånn at vi ikke er fullstendig avhengig av det, og at vi fortsetter å jobbe effektivt selv om vi skulle miste konnektiviteten.
Lars?
Helt enig, og spesielt det siste poenget, altså det å delegere, og det blir vår oppgave å delegere beslutningsmyndigheten så lavt ned som det bare går an, slik at selv om ikke det store bildet er der, på grunn av at vi mister systemet, så vil vi kunne få til det samvirke lokalt og dermed møte den overordnede intensjonen.
Samtidig så er det ikke tvil om at i et høyteknologisk all domain samvirkeforsvar så er vi veldig avhengig av kommandokontrollsystemer og løsninger som gjør at vi både kan snakke sammen, dele sensorinformasjon og guide våpen inn mot målet. Og så er det at du har robuste systemer som er både fleksible og i flere lag, slik at hvis du mister noe så har du noe annet som kan ta over. Kombinert med at vi må også evne, som Nils Andreas poengterer, at dersom alt går i svart, så har du intensjonen, du har forhåndsplanlagt og programmert, så du kan utøve det oppdraget du står i med god vurdering og den kompetansen og de egenskaper du har i din egen avdeling der og da.
Good afternoon and welcome to the final day of this year's Army Summit. We've had some really good discussions so far, and there's still some more to come. Yesterday, we talked about the future of joint operations and how the armed forces collectively can adapt to an increasingly unpredictable environment, both at home and abroad. Today, our discussions will look at what uncertainty and resilience means in the context of whole-of-government approaches. To address some of these topics, we're fortunate enough to have with us today General Ben Hodges from the Center for European Policy and Analysis, former U.S. Commanding General in Europe, as well as Minister of Foreign Affairs Ine Eriksen Søreide.
I do believe that we're going to be in a kinetic conflict with China in the next 5 years. Obviously, I hope I'm wrong on that. But I think it's the case. And the United States does not have the capacity to deal with China, to deter Russia, to contain Iran, to try and protect all the global commons. Our great Navy is stretched. Even with the world's largest defense budget in history, we do not have the capacity to do everything that needs to be done. And so we've got to figure out how do we make sure that Europe remains safe and secure, but there's not going to be a large American footprint. There's going to be a commitment, and I think you can challenge me on this here in a few minutes, Aisha, or maybe somebody in the audience. But we are in need of allies now more than ever, probably in the last 80 years. We need allies now. We need a strong European pillar, not a European pillow. And that's why there's so much emphasis on this 2%, on burden sharing. Norway, of course, does well. You are one of the most modernized forces. You're famous for the total defense concept, the quality of people, young men and women that join the forces. I've seen Norwegians all over Europe. I had the chance to visit some of the border outposts with General Jakobsen back a few years ago. It's amazing. And to see how much responsibility is put on young people, I love that. But it's also difficult to accept that a nation like Norway still has not been able to reach the agreed upon 2% obligation of investment in your own defense. And especially considering how exposed Norway is and how important air and maritime forces are, as well as land forces, it's a little bit hard to understand. And so I think this is something that Norwegians are going to have to address. Clearly, the top priority has to be on readiness. The second priority, readiness. The third priority, readiness. Making sure that the equipment you have is modernized and it works, that formations are trained and fully manned. After that, I think it's time for a little bit more innovative approach to what 2% means. What the alliance needs is the ability to move quickly, to move fast. And so investment in transportation perhaps should count towards 2%. Cyber protection of transportation networks, and certainly integrated air and missile defense.
But what can we do to mitigate such a conflict? Clearly, war is not in our interest. So what are, in your opinion, the steps we can take as an alliance to mitigate?
Well, the absolute number one priority for that is cohesion, where in NATO and with allies in the Pacific, that there is not a doubt about American commitment and the willingness to do what it takes. That's number one. Number two is, and I'm sure this is what the Norwegian Army leadership is focused on, is on readiness, on being prepared to do your job. That's what deterrence is all about. Deterrence is in the mind of the potential attacker, whether it's the Kremlin or the Chinese Communist Party. And if they look across and they see that you've got modernized forces, you can move quickly, you're alert, well-trained, that is the best way to make sure this never happens. And see that you anchor NATO's northern flank. It's so important that we have strength all the way from the northern tip of the alliance to the southeastern tip, Turkey, and then the Black Sea. Number one, because these are allies that have to be protected, but also to give the alliance some flexibility, some options for what we call horizontal escalation. If the Kremlin were to attempt to do something, perhaps say in Lithuania around the Suwalki corridor or in Romania, having real capability on the northern flank is important, just like it is on the southern flank.
We are in a way not stronger as a military alliance than our political cohesion.
Exactly.
And that's the point where I want to stress that NATO also needs to focus equally much on the political cohesion, our political unity, as we have been, rightly so, doing with the ramp up of our military capabilities since 2014.
So this question, you said we are over delivering on defense investments, NATO's 20% guideline. Mm-hmm. Is this just not creating an unsustainable defense structure?
I don't think so, because, and I will not go into all the details from past history, but one of the main priorities when we issued our current long-term plan, which will now be replaced by a new one shortly, was to make sure that we had a balance in this. So we didn't employ more capabilities than we could actually run on an annual basis. And to make sure that it was enough funding set aside for exercise, for training, not least to maintenance, which is a huge issue. So we also made an arrangement to make sure that the annual increase in costs were taken care of in each budget so that you wouldn't lose consumer power year by year. That was extremely important because that adds to the balance. And we do this in a very, I mean, a long-term perspective.
Yeah.
So we had a, I mean, it's a 4-year long-term plan, but we had a 20-year planning perspective to make sure that when the investments were at its height of payments, that not everything came exactly at once. So this is part of
it's a
long-term
balance,
planning.
Yeah. This is a question I personally have an issue with, but I'm still going to ask it. We have locked 1% to foreign aid. Why is it so hard to lock 2% to defense?
Oh, well, I think the good answer to that is that we are, as I said, very, very close to the 2% target right now. And that it has been a part of a systematic prioritization from the government side. And it is also for us very heartening to see that this actually gathers a lot of political support in parliament. Mm. Only one or two parties do not abide by the 2%
you
target.
You say you're close, but you're not there.
But we
and there's a difference between being at 2% and not being at 2%.
Absolutely. But I think that, well, the budget will be presented next week, so I think we'll see more of it there. But I think that where we came from when we got into government in 2013 was below 1.5. And the increases that we've done with about 30% of the budget is actually quite a heavy lifting. And it has been alongside infrastructure and health the main priority for the government since 2013. Mm. So the sums are large, I would say.
The 11th annual Army Summit is coming to an end. Army Summit 2020 had to change. Our tried and trusted format did not fit the reality of the pandemic. And rather than trying to hold on to the past, we wanted to look to the future. To quote one of our most beloved national poets, Nordahl Grieg, who also lived and worked in tumultuous times, "Surrounded by enemies, enter into your time." Enemies can take many shapes, and the first step in taking control of a new situation is to understand its context. Adjusting to the current operational environment, this year's new format has still allowed us the opportunity to listen to and discuss important topics with distinguished speakers like General Jim Mattis and General Ben Hodges. I've also had the pleasure to discuss joint operations and even closer cooperation with my counterparts in the Navy and Air Force. This kind of open, joint discussion was a useful format that we will explore further. The word trust has been one of the most frequently used words throughout the 3 days of this event. And I don't think that's a coincidence. Trust builds cohesion. Cohesion wins wars. I firmly believe that trust is one of the strengths in our open and liberal democracies. We trust our neighbors, we trust our brothers and sisters in arms, our authorities, and our allies. I believe that through the open and frank discussion we have had at this year's Army Summit, we have provided valuable insight into some of the challenges our armed forces are facing right now and will be facing in the future. In addition to acknowledging the increasingly harsh reality, our discussion has shown support, both from our political leaders and from our allies, for the need to strengthen the Norwegian army. Reviewing discussed trends, threats, and our goal of maintaining both assurance and deterrence. I feel safe that our priorities to invest in new main battle tanks, air defense systems, and long-range fires are more than sound. Our numbers must grow in order to have the adequate volume to manage the risks we are facing and to be able to sustain the fight over time. A firm political commitment is necessary. We are looking forward to it. A future strengthened Norwegian army with increased readiness and combat power as a part of our joint team is critical to solving the defense mission and avoiding war. We are ready to grow, and we can grow fast.